lexical level must account for. These tense relations pertain to homonymy, polysemy, synonymy, opposites or antonymy, hyponymy, collocation, and componential analysis. Starting with the tense relations of homonymy, first, what is meant by the concept of homonymy as an aspect of sense relations in English? Homonyms are unrelated senses of the same phonological word. Of course, some scholars distinguish between homographs, which are senses of the same written word, and homophones, which are senses of the same spoken word. But for our purposes, we will stick to the term homonym. And of course, we can distinguish four different types of homonyms in English depending on their syntactic behavior, that is, depending on their part of speech function in sentences and spelling. For example, first, there are lexemes or words of the same syntactic category, that is, belonging to the same parts of speech and with the same spelling. Let's take the example of the word bank, B-A-N-K, bank. Bank has two meanings or two senses. The first meaning of bank is that it is a financial institution, while the other sense of property of bank is that it may relate to the edge of a street. But the most important thing to know here is that bank is pronounced the same, but then has two different meanings. The second type of homonymy in English are lexemes of the same category but with different spelling. For example, take the noun key. The first one is spelled with K-E-Y, but it's pronounced key. And the second one is spelled Q-U-A-Y, but with the same pronunciation of key. But these two words have different senses or properties of meanings. For example, the first sense of key is that is normally metal instrument by which the bone of a lock is strong, while the other sense property of key is that it is a structure built on the land next to a river. The third category of homonyms in English are lexemes or words of different categories but with the same spelling. Take the word go, G-O, go, which can be used as a verb, as in the sentence, you may go now. But of course, there is the second use of go as a noun, as in the sentence, he sometimes has to eat his breakfast on the go. Of course, the key thing to know here is that go is a homonym that can be used as both as a verb and as a noun. And finally, lexemes were words of different categories and with different spelling. For example, take the word not, spelled N-O-T, and not, spelled K-N-O-T. Of course, not, that is N-O-T, and not, K-N-O-T, are pronounced the same. They are homophones, but they have different meanings or senses. Not N-O-T, you know, not N-O-T is normally an adverb or a particle of negation. Why not? Okay, can be used as a verb. I mean, which could mean to tie a section of rope, string, fabric, and so on. Of course, the flip side of homonymy is the concept of polysemy. And several scholars have pointed out that there is a traditional distinction made in lexical semantics between homonymy and polysemy. Of course, both senses or both concepts deal with multiple senses of the same phonological word, but polysemy is invoked if the senses are judged to be related. So, there is an important distinction for lexicographers, that is, those who compile dictionaries, in the design of their dictionaries, because polysemous senses are listed under the same lexical entry in dictionaries, while homonyms are given separate entries in dictionaries. Thus, the word head can be considered a case of polysemy, and as such, all the meanings or senses of head will be listed under the same entry in a dictionary. And that brings us to the concept of synonymy, which is central to the study and analysis of sense relations in English. Consider the following pair of sentences in relation to synonyms. Sentence A, Jack is a seaman. Sentence B, Jack is a sailor. In sentences A and B, we can assume that seaman and sailor are synonyms or are synonymous. Of course, synonyms can be nouns, as in the previous examples of sailor and seaman, or they can be adjectives, adverbs, or verbs, as in the following example. The rock is large means the same thing as the rock is big. Of course, in this pair of sentences, large and big are synonymous, but functionally they are adjectives. The train traveled fast versus the train traveled rapidly. Again, in this pair of sentences, fast and rapidly are synonymous, but syntactically they function as adverbs. Or in the following pair of sentences, the bus left promptly at 10 versus B, the bus departed promptly at 10. Of course, here we are concerned with left and departed, because which are antonyms or opposites. But in these two sentences, left and departed, although synonymous, function syntactically as verbs. And according to a scholar, synonyms in most cases have different distributions along a number of parameters. First, there may be a dialectal difference. For example, you take the words autumn and fall. These two words are synonyms, but dialectically, autumn belongs to British English, while fall belongs to American English. Similarly, the words postman and mailman are synonymous, but while postman is largely used in British English, mailman is associated with American English. Or you take the words sandwich and butter, which are synonyms in Britain, but the former belongs to what is called standard English, while the latter, that is butter, belongs to what is called regional dialects of English. Second, concerning the distributional criteria of Sierra Leone, there may be what is called a stylistic difference. For example, the words insane and loony are synonymous, but stylistically, that is, in terms of usage, insane belongs to formal English, while loony belongs to what is called informal or colloquial English. Or you take the two synonyms, salt and sodium chloride. Sodium belongs to what is called common English, common everyday English. But of course, we know that sodium chloride is not used all the time, which means that sodium chloride, although a synonym of salt, is largely technical in usage. Third, there may be a collocational difference between synonyms. Take the two words, rancid and rotten. In certain contexts, these words are synonymous, but the word rancid is used only of butter or bacon. So I mean, one can say the butter has grown rancid, but bacon is mainly associated with meat or beef. So somebody can say the bacon, the beef has grown rotten, or the beef or meat is rotten. For example, the following sentences might mean roughly the same thing in some context. So I mean, when we say she lives in a big house, this could mean the same thing as she lives in a large house. But compare the foregoing examples with the following pair of sentences. Of course, it is normal to say meet my big sister, but it's not normal to say meet my large sister. I mean, similarly, as noted by Kreutzer in 1998, the verbs hide and conceal also deal, also differ in what is called pragmatic value. For example, hide is more common than conceal, and they differ in potential co-occurrence or collocation. For example, we might say we hid in the garage, as well as we hid the treasure in the garage. But it is not normal in English to say we concealed in the garage. Finally, on the distributional criteria of synonyms in English, there may be a difference of connotation, or generally speaking, emotional feeling. For example, we know that youth and youngsters are synonymous, but youths are considered to be less pleasant than youngsters. Also, consider the following three sentences. Sentence A. Alice is skinny. Sentence B. Alice is thin. And sentence C. Alice is slender. Of course, in certain contexts, those three adjectives mean the same thing, but they differ in what is known as connotation or the values that people ascribe to the use of these words. So, I mean, one can say that thin has a neutral meaning, while skinny has what is called a negative or pejorative meaning, while the third, that is slender, has what is known as a flattery meaning. Now, let us talk about antonymy, of course, which can be considered as the flip side of synonymy. Consider the following two sentences. Sentence A, Jack is watching television now. Versus sentence B, Jack is not watching television now. The point here is that two sentences that differ in polarity like these are mutually contradictory. which presupposes that if one is true, then the other must be false. So true sentences that have the same subject and have predicates which are antonyms are also mutually contradictory. Let's consider the other examples of antonymous pairs in English. For example, sentence A, Mr. Adams is an old man, versus sentence B, Mr. Adams is a young man. Of course, these two sentences are mutually contradictory because old and young are two words that are not compatible with each other. Antonyms may be nouns, like communist and non-communist, or verbs, such as the words advance and retreat. But we need to know that antonymous pairs of adjectives are especially numerous. English has various pairs of measure, what are called measure adjectives. Of course, the focus here is on that key phrase, measure adjectives, like the following: long versus short, tall versus short, high versus low, wide versus narrow, old versus young, and so on. These are measure adjectives because they can be combined with expressions of measuring. So one can say that the lane is 4 feet long, or that the fence is 2 meters high, or that my sister is 19 years old. And several scholars have pointed out that there are specific kinds of antonyms in English, and these are mainly binary and non-binary antonyms, reverses, converses, and what are known as taxonomic systems. But I mean, what do we mean by the distinction between binary and non-binary antonyms? For example, in our previous example, on and off are binary antonyms. And that means the light or radio or television set is either on or off, meaning that those words are non-readable. There is no middle ground. Other binary pairs are the words open and shut, dead and alive, sleep and awake, and so on. But what this means is that somebody is either asleep or is awake. There's no middle ground. By the same token, the terms old are young and non-binary antonyms, and so are wide and narrow. On the question of reverses as example of antonym in English, the characteristic, the typical reverse relation is between terms describing movement or motion, where one term describes movement in one direction and the other the same movement in the opposite direction. For example, if you take the words push and pull on a swing door, which tell you in which direction to apply force. And that means you can push a swing door or pull the same swing door. Of course, when describing motion in general, the following can be called reverses. And that means go up or down, you can go in or out of the room, or you can turn right or left. By extension, the term reverses is also applied to any process which can be reversed. So, take the words inflate and deflate. because this qualifies as reverses, because one can inflate a football, and by the same process, one can deflate, that means let the air out of that football, or an iron can expand or contract, fill versus empty, and that means one can fill up a bucket with water, and by the same token, one can empty that bucket of water. Converses are another aspect of sense relations in English, but with particular reference to antonyms. And as described by a scholar, converses are terms which denote a relation between two things from alternate viewpoints, as in the following converse pairs: own and belong to mean roughly the same thing, above and below, employer and employee, before and after, precede and follow, buy and sell, and lend and borrow. One should know that both members of converse pairs express what is essentially the same relationship, but viewed from the vantage point of different participants. Thus, if we are told that John owns this book, then we know that this belongs to John. Of course, the two concepts here, or the two words here, as you know, are owns and belongs to, of course, which form converse pairs. Or in the sentence, Mary is David's employer, of course, means the same thing as David is Mary's employee. So, for many semanticists, converse relations are a part of a speaker's semantic knowledge and show why the following pairs of sentences are paraphrases, that is, they can be viewed to describe the same situation. Let's take just a few examples of this. For example, sentence A, my office is above the library, means roughly the same thing as the library is below my office. Or if we are told that John sold the car to Michael, we know automatically that Michael bought the car from John. Of course, taxonomic systems are another aspect of antonymy in English. Of course, taxonomic systems are used to describe words which are of the same level in a taxonomy or in a level. For example, the so-called color adjectives in English form what are known as taxonomic systems in English. Colors such as red, orange, yellow, green, blue, purple, and brown. Other taxonomies might include the days of the week. For example, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and so on. Of course, the key point to note here is that some taxonomies are closed. For example, the days of the week. The days of the week cannot be changed. The days of the week will start from Sunday and then end on a Saturday. So that taxonomy is closed. One cannot change the 7 days of the week without altering the old calendar system. But other taxonomies are open, like the flavors of ice cream sold in the ice cream parlor. And that means someone can always come up with a new flavor and thus extend the taxonomy. In fact, there is an ice cream parlor in one of the Caribbean islands which is said to have 1001 ice cream flavors. Eipolene, the concept of Eipolene is also central to semantic relations in English, especially when we talk about sense relations in English. Broadly defined, Eipolene is a relation of inclusion. A hypoleme includes the meaning of a more general word. For example, dog and cat are hypolemes of animal, while sister and mother are hypolemes of woman. Of course, in ordinary language, what we are trying to say is that dog and cat are types of kinds of animals, while sister and mother are types of kinds of woman. The more general term is called the superordinate term or the hyponym. So one can say that dog and cat are the hyponyms, while animal is the hyponym. Or we can say the sister and mother are the hyponyms, while woman is the superordinate term or the hyponym.